Game one of the NBA season is in the books for the Dallas Mavericks, and they open their season with a... Now, the score might not jump out at you as convincing, but they controlled the entire game until they started messing around a little bit too much late in the game. Dallas ends up winning 108-100, but they held a 23-point lead early in the fourth quarter. I think it was a 22-point lead going into the fourth quarter, so... Dallas really had this game in complete control, and they should. Washington's not a good team at all this year. They have Bradley Beal and basically a box of extra parts right now, and none of those parts are anything particularly scary. And even then, Bradley Beal had a pretty day. Like, yeah, he had 19 points, 6 rebounds, and 9 assists, so he filled out the stat sheet, but he only shot 7 of 25 from the field, 1 of 11 on three-pointers, and 4 of 6 at the line. So he had a very up and down day. He wasn't what killed you. Dallas controlled this game for the most part. It was only when they started playing around a little bit too much late and started getting a little, for lack of a better term, showboaty, that things got a little bit tighter than you want. But Dallas looked really good in this game. You had Luka come out, and a little bit of a slow start for Luka, but nothing crazy. He got going in the second quarter when he wanted to assert his will halfway through the second quarter. He did. I mean, he absolutely took over the game. Luka was phenomenal. 34 points in 34 minutes, 9 rebounds, 3 assists. He shot 12 of 19 from the field. So any talk about, oh, his field goal percentage, I get it. It's one game, right? And we just talked about how Washington, yeah, they had Beal try and check him a little bit, and Beal even tried to get into his head, which led to some tension and kind of entertainment late in the game. But it wasn't a problem. Luka shot 4 of 9 on threes. Even at the free throw line, 6 of 8, although he did miss when the Mavericks were messing around a little bit too much. They had twice in a row, almost in a row, where Washington got a technical, put someone from Dallas on the line. First time Porzingis, second time Luka, both of them missed. That's going to have to improve. But even still, Dallas looked pretty good here, and Luka is absolutely the engine behind this thing. He had a wonderful game for Dallas. Porzingis, let's talk about the big guy making his first regular season NBA play in 20 months, over 20 months. Porzingis, he started slow. He started out missing his first 4 shots, then he got a bucket, then he missed a couple more. At one point, he was only shooting 4 of 12 from the field, which led to some Knicks fans kind of running their mouth on Twitter, kind of gloating in that, like, oh, RJ Barrett's having a great game. The Knicks are currently winning. By the way, they lost. And, Porzingis is only 4 of 12. Life is good. It's going to be a good year. Well, Porzingis ended up getting 23 points, 4 rebounds. I really want that number to improve. I was hoping to be a little closer to what we saw in his last preseason game with 13 boards. Obviously, I didn't think that was going to be the average, but I wanted to see him kind of assert himself a little bit more. And he still has plenty of time to, obviously. But 4, that's, dude, Luka got 9, and Luka's 5 inches shorter than you. So... it is what it is. 2 assists as well for Porzingis. He gets a block in the game. Altered a whole lot more shots, though. And he ends up shooting 7 of 16 for the game. So I talked about he was 4 of 12. He ends up 7 of 16. 3 of 7 from behind the arc. And then 6 of 7 at the line. I mentioned his aforementioned miss, the technical free throw late in the game. And he even got a steal. So, hey, Porzingis filled out the stat chart and everything. I feel pretty good with what this team accomplished yesterday because it was the driving force we expected, right? Luka and KP, 57 combined points between those two guys. That is the engine Dallas needs night in, night out. Because while they have a lot of good role players around them, they don't have that third guy, right? DeLon Wright, who we would like to see him kind of fill out that role a little bit, he only took 2 shots on the night. I think he missed a 2-point attempt, but he did knock down a 3 at one point in the game and early on in the game off a pass from Luka. So we need more there, but DeLon Wright defended well, rebounded pretty well as well for them. So as far as points and all that, DeLon Wright's probably going to be a 9 to 11 point per night guy, most likely. Nothing's sexy about his game in that regard. But, you know, he had a good sense and a good feel for things, and he was able to check them. Now, Dallas did make the interesting decision to start Courtney Lee. That was the fifth starter. It was not Justin Jackson. It was not even Dorian Finney-Smith, which I expected. This is because Rick Carlisle stated that looking through all the tape of their guys who have defended against Bradley Beal, he felt like the best guy on their roster was Courtney Lee. That's an interesting statement because I didn't really see a whole lot of Courtney Lee doing much against Beal. I mean, Lee played, you know, the first few minutes of the game, disappeared for a long stretch, came back for a few more minutes. Like, Courtney Lee's minutes were not high in this game. So I don't know what the assessment was there. I think Carlisle also, whether he says it or not, I think he likes to have that steady veteran presence. And Courtney Lee is, what, 32 years old? He's been around for a while. So I think he looked at it like that and just said, you know what, we had a lot of youth here. We had a lot of guys who were going to be a little angsty perhaps. Let's get a veteran in here and just kind of run the ship smoothly a little bit. So it is what it is. But hey, when they got their chances, Jack's 44 Jacks. I flipped that both ways because I can never decide which sounds better. 44 Jacks had 10 points in the game as well. He did badly miss a three-pointer, airballed it. And I was like, you weren't supposed to do that. What are you doing? I've been talking you up all offseason, and you do that to me. Specifically talking up his three-point shooting. But, you know, it is what it is. He had 10 points, shot a good percentage. I think he was like 4 or 5 on the game. And he got a lot of floaters, a lot of inside shots of the rim, a good feel for where to be within the flow of the offense, spacing, spatial awareness, all that. Dorian Finney-Smith had a good game as well, 10 points, played some pretty good defense. Seth Curry had himself a really nice stretch when Dallas was still kind of in the midway in the second quarter, locked in this game, and it was kind of tight. Seth Curry and really the second unit, but Curry in particular, really spearheaded Dallas ahead because Curry splashes a three, gets a beautiful runner off the glass, and then I think he got another runner a minute or so later. I mean, he got like 7 of his 9 points like that. I mean, it was just boom, boom, boom. It was just quick succession, and that's about what you're going to get from him. Now, I think he only took 2 3-point attempts on the game, so that's going to go up, I would hope. I would expect him to get more minutes in certain matchups and all of that, but you know, when you got a guy that can shoot that kind of lights out, it's going to open some things up for you. And the prospect, I was already excited about the prospect of this, looking at it and saying, dude, give me a lineup with Luka, with Curry, with Porzingis, with Jackson. Give me that, and then you can either throw in Dwight Powell, the best rim runner on this team, or Maxey. The Maxey KP front court didn't look so great to me. I don't think they work as well together. We know Maxey and Dwight play really well together, but I felt like that lineup isn't ideal, but Dwight Powell says he's about 95% back from the hamstring. He did not play. So you're just going to have to kind of mix and match with that for now and make it work. But another noteworthy thing for the Mavericks in this game, Tim Hardaway Jr. goes down with what looks like a really nasty ankle turn early on in the game. He stays down for a minute or so. As soon as the Mavericks finally call timeout after advancing the ball into the front court, Luka Doncic jumps up and he sprints down to his teammate there. I don't know how much of that is just Luka being Luka or how much of that is because he's a professional and because, you know, he's been the guy on these teams for a while now, and this is his team unquestionably. I'm not trying to say it's insincere by any means at all, so please do not read into that. But I wonder how much of it is just that's his natural tendency versus kind of understanding, like, I'm the leader here. This is my team. And so, you know, part of having guys willing to fight for you and run through a wall for you, it's not just infectious by your play, it's infectious by your personality. And when you actually look like you give a rip about your teammates, that's going to go a long way. So, you know, that's one element that Jimmy Butler's never had, for example. That's all I'm trying to say in that regard. But that is what it is. Hardaway Jr. does return later in the game, even hits a couple shots. He gets 4 points on the night. I think Hardaway Jr. is, if there's a third man, so to speak, on this roster, it's him or it's Jackson, I feel like. DeLon Wright, I think he'll be a really solid piece for you, and he'll do some good damage here and there, but I really think it's going to be one of those guys in terms of the third leading scorer that can give that to you. I think it's either going to be Jackson stepping up or Hardaway Jr. We know that he is a shoot-first, ask-questions-later kind of guy. And so you put him out there and you bring him in off the bench, he's going to look for his shot. Now, unfortunately, in this game, you know, he takes the nasty fall and he misses a chunk of the game, comes back though, so that's good. This game got a little dicey late, as I mentioned. The Mavericks had a huge lead in this game, 23 points going into the fourth quarter, but then things got a little bit chippy. You actually saw it, and it was cool because the crowd actually noticed it too. Bradley Beal basically saying, like, all right, we're out of this game right now. The only way we're going to do anything, and look for this, all season long, look for this. You saw it some last year. I'm telling you it's going to be even higher this year now. teams are going to try and go at Luka. They're going to try and get under his skin and see if they can throw him off his game. Now, it wasn't working. You could say that. He had 32, I think, going into the fourth quarter, ended with 35. So I guess you could say it kind of worked, but Luka didn't look for his shot a whole lot in that fourth quarter. And when he did it with such flash and flair that I think it kind of annoyed the Wizards players in that regard. So Bradley Beal starts picking up Luka, at the half court, just really hounding him, staying physical with him and all that. He got away with a lot before they finally actually made a call of a foul in that case. And as things got a little chippier, the Wizards started to whittle away at that lead. They cut a 23-point lead all the way down to 7. I know some people are going to say, oh, that's coaching. It's Carlisle. That's the problem in that case. I don't see that. I saw the Mavericks have 6 turnovers in 11 possessions in the fourth quarter at one point, and they just weren't making shots. And then when they would get fouled and go to the free throw line, which, by the way, they were taking a lot of jump shots, but even when they got there via technicals or the rare fouls where they actually did draw contact, they just weren't making free throws. So you have to... That's player execution. You have to execute on that. Now, you could say, well, Carlisle, switch out some other guys that aren't turning the ball over, but I don't have a problem with that. Some part of it, you just have to work through it a little bit as well. So the team looked pretty good in that regard, but things got chippy all the same. The lead whittled down. Beal's getting up in Luka's grill. You get a double technical assessed on them at one point. Before the double technical, you have this awesome moment where Luka crosses over Beal. And now Brunson was coming to set a screen on Beal, and their feet got just not tangled, but just enough of a grazing glance between their feet that Beal falls hard, but it's on the crossover, so it just looks like Luka just shattered his ankles, Beal's ankles, and the ref calls a foul. Luka's mad, though, because he knows, like, Beal's checking him, and Luka's wanting to, like, Luka's competitive. He's like, okay, we want to make this 1-on-1. You want to try and D me up? I'm going to drop you on your ass, and damn it, they called a foul, they called a trip. So it comes back, it is what it is, but the crowd chanting MVP at Luka as he's shooting free throws in the fourth quarter pretty much erupted, and then were outraged when the trip was called, even though I think it is the correct call. They wanted that moment for Luka because they understood what was happening. Beal was trying to punk Luka, and Luka's like, nah, I'm not backing down. Not only am I not backing down, I'm going to drop you on your ass as a result of that. So it sucked to lose that moment. Then you get the double technical as they're kind of trash talking a little bit back and forth. Beal, upon seeing he gets a technical, like, kind of scoffs at the ref, waves it off or whatever, and then the ref double tees him up. Man, the officiating sucked in this game. I'm going to say that, first of all. I understand. This is the thing. Look for a million travel calls to be called this year, because for whatever reason, don't get me wrong, the NBA has needed for years to address how blatant and ridiculous the traveling issue is in that league. But at the same time, they called like 14 travel calls on the game, and at least 3 or 4 of them, you're like, I wanted to travel. Like, his pivot foot was down as he initiated his dribble. It's like the referees are just looking for it and assuming it's there because it so regularly is there that it's, eh. But there were a lot of stoppages in this game, whether we're talking about turnovers, travels, fouls, whatever. It just felt like a very iffy game, and like I said, things got chippy late, and it felt like the officials weren't really doing much to quell the chippiness of it. You had the issue with Luka and with Beal, but then even on the technicals and then ejecting Beal, it's like you're not controlling the thing, because now the crowd's getting all bent out of shape. Now the crowd did cheer a little bit when Beal got ejected, but it is what it is. Like, it just looked like you guys aren't managing this very well, and it's just not a well officiated game. If this is the template for how we're going to be officiating games this year, I'm not excited about that, because it drew the game out longer than it needed to be, and it just kills the flow of the game. And basketball, one of the best things about it is poetry in motion when you just let guys go, when you just let the rhythm of the game work. It's not like the NFL where it's run one play, all right, now stop for about 20, 30 seconds while we get everything set back up and get ready to go again. No, it is just go. That is one thing I've always liked about basketball compared to football. And with all this stoppages and all that, it just felt like it wasn't as enjoyable as it could be and should be for the team. So it is what it is. But yeah, this is an interesting game here for the Mavericks, because they come out, they look good. Oh, and Brunson had 9 points. I forgot to mention that earlier, too, as I was running through the notable guys. Minutes were a little interesting in this game. You had Brunson not get as many minutes as I thought he should. I didn't feel like Jackson got a ton of minutes. Early on in the game, Luka came out about the halfway point of the first quarter, around the four-minute mark, so not the halfway, about three-quarters through the first quarter, and he didn't come back until the six, almost seven-minute mark of the second quarter, which felt like a long time for Luka to be out. They did stagger him and KP, as we expected them to, which allowed us to get a good look at each guy together and separate, which I think is good because when you're able to stagger guys like that but still play them together as well from time to time, I think you give both of them a chance to kind of, okay, work myself into the game and get ready, and then when the time comes, I'm ready to play off of this guy now. So it worked out. I think that was a pretty good thing. I want to see more assists out of Luka for a guy that talked about, you know, his goal being potentially to lead the NBA in assists this year. You're off to a rough start with three, but his movement and the way that he created on the night was good. It's just some of these shots didn't go down, and I think Luka was in a little bit more attack mode, especially after he got going, than he was in create mode. So a good game for the Mavericks. I don't like kind of how they handled the fourth quarter, but, you know, it is what it is. You get a young team that gets up on a big lead and just everything's going. Luka's doing the showboating kind of stuff a little bit and running past the Wizards bench as he does it. I kind of had a feeling then things were going to get a little chippy and a little more physical, and they did. I mean, you saw guys, Luka gets whacked in the face late in the game. Looks like he might have a slight bruise or something forming under his eye around his cheekbone. And things just got a little bit physical, a little bit chippy, and it just felt like a young team kind of having fun and flexing, and they kind of let their foot off the other team's throat a little bit, and then things got real tight all of a sudden, and then they're like, oh, no, okay, steady down, here's the ball back with Luka, and let's close it out. Like, that's cool, but you gotta control it better. A better team would have probably clawed all the way back in. Even still, you let Washington with just Bradley Beal, who hit 1-3 on the night and less than 20 points, scrap and claw back into single digits, 7 points. So after the game, Luka talked about Bradley Beal, just saying, you know, hey, that's basketball. I have no problem with how he was guarding me. I have no problem with the physicality to it. Obviously, he's a great offensive player, but he's also a really good and persistent defensive player. He basically just said, you know, I respect him, and I was enjoying it. That's basketball. Like, Luka, when Beal got thrown out of the game, I think Luka was a little bit bummed out, too, because he's like, no, this is fun for me. Like, this guy's coming at me, and now it's my chance to respond, and it's the competitive nature. And so when he got thrown out, I think Luka was kind of bummed out about that. And then after the game, you know, Beal talked a little bit about Luka. He's like, yeah, no, he's one of the better, you know, he has a bright future. He's one of the better young talents. He knows exactly what he's doing out there, and he's very versatile, can very much dictate the game. So it is what it is. It's just a show of respect between two competitors. I wasn't mad at Beal or anything like that. I was actually more angry at the guy. I think it was Wagner who bonked Luka a couple times, and then you had Luka get a shot in the face from, I think it was McCraw? I can't remember exactly who it was on Washington that popped Luka in the face late in the game, but it was what led to the MVP chance while he was at the line. So this was a good first start for the Mavericks. It's good to start out 1-0. Haven't done that in a while. I've talked about before how slow their starts have been in the first half of the season, really specifically the first 10 to 20 games. And so it's good to start out with this. Now they're going to go to New Orleans on Friday. They get to face the Pelicans without Zion Williamson. He's out, I think it's 6 to 8 weeks recovering from meniscus surgery. So in that regard, I feel pretty good about their chances in that game too. Now, you know, we know Toronto doesn't have Kawhi obviously anymore, but New Orleans did go to overtime in Toronto. So they're not a bad team by any means. It's not like I'm saying it's a layup, but I do feel pretty good about Dallas's chances here. And if they can kind of keep their focus for a complete game and not take their foot off the gas like they did against Washington, I think they have a very reasonable chance of starting 2-0. Also, look out, before I jump off here, look out for Sunday night. We got a 6 o'clock tip against the Portland Trail Blazers. I think Innie and I are going to do a game companion on the channel. So that's something for you guys to look forward to as well. You can join here in the chat and talk with us, and you'll get our kind of commentary and just us just kind of riffing back and forth and everything like that. So that's all my time for this video, guys. Thank you so much for watching. Until next time, just remember, every legend was once a prospect. Salute.